Thank you. Good afternoon. After an exciting keynote speech that somehow attempts to find relations and connections between differences, my paper is focusing on difference. I mean, when we are talking of relating differences, we need to identify the differences. But what happens when we somehow try to ignore differences and homogenize? This is the focus of my paper. So the title is Delinking English Literature Pedagogy Bangladesh Towards a Critical Pedagogical Approach. Now, let me start with a common yet complicated question. If the UK competes as Team GB in the Olympic, why does it play football as individual countries, say England and Scotland? More confusing question is, do the word England in the English football team and England in the England cricket team mean the same? The answer is no. The England cricket team comprises England and Wales. This terminological problem becomes more disorienting when someone attempts to differentiate between Britain, United Kingdom and the British Isles. To be precise, acknowledging debates, we may say that Great Britain refers to a political island nation, United Kingdom a geopolitical entity, and British Isles a geographical or archaeological entity. Now, finding one's way to these complexities is not only complex, but in many cases it can become offensive if it puts your identity at stake. When Shimasini was included in the 1982 Penguin Book of Contemporary British Poetry, he responded in a sarcastic poem and took the letter. This is the British arts. So Shimasini responded in a sarcastic poem and took the letter. I hate light. Hands that led me to the limelight. The Penguin Book, I regret your offense. British. No, the name's not right. It is therefore unfortunate that similar kinds of uncritical and strangely politically offensive activities are evident in the departments of English in the world. In Bangladesh, we focus the English language or Anglophone literatures of Ireland, Scotland and Wales have been uncritically crammed under the umbrella term English literature. Thus, English literature syllabuses feature Anglophone Irish James Joyce, Anglophone Welsh Dylan Thomas as English writers. However, Anglophone Nigerian Chima Achebe and Anglophone Canadian Margaret Atwood are not in English proper. And often is British themed synonymous with English. Such British large interest in homogenization has led to two hegemonic pedagogic approaches. First, naturalization of the ambiguity and superiority of the literatures produced in England, and second, invisibilization of the different, often oppositional, histories and trajectories of the Anglophone and non-Anglophone literatures of Ireland, Scotland and Wales. In response, my paper samples a strategy of delinking the English literature pedagogy in Bangladesh. The question that spurred my paper is, should the Joyce and Thomas be put in a differently titled courses, say, Anglophone Welsh and Irish literatures? Addressing these paradoxes and perplexities, John Brannigan, who wrote a useful book, Archaeologic Modernism, he located two modes that dominate the study of literature of the British Isles. The first is the Anglocentric mode, views Joyce and Yeats as exemplary of metropolitan modernism. The other is national narrative mode that views Joyce and Yeats predominantly in relation to their Irish national traditions. What may strike a productive synergy is a critical affective mode that I would like to call critical archaeologic mode. For Brannigan, the archaeologic accommodates the post-evolutionary or post-decentralization cultural context of the study of literatures of the British Isles. If Brexit is Britain's exit from European Union, post-evolutionary exit from the political and cultural domination of England in the British archipelago. archipelagic approach endorses decentration. But thus it remains sensitive to what is distinctive about the linguistic, cultural, and political histories of literature in each of the constituent parts of the archipelago. My today's talk proposes a critical archipelagic mode as a pedagogic mechanism at the university's fundamentals to dealing the study of literatures of England from the study of Anglophone literatures of Ireland, Scotland, and Wales. And here goes the three sections through which my argument will unfold. The first section tells the emancipatory potential of delinking the study of the literatures of the British and Irish elites in Bangladesh. The second section enumerates what I mean by critical pedagogical approach, critical archaeologic approach, and the third section outlines a critical archaeologic mode of teaching literatures of the British and Irish elites in Bangladesh. So the first section, I need to shed back some light on delinking. We Global South teach that in their conviction that Global South poetics and literatures provide literary, theoretical, and critical touchstones and philosopher stones, a kind of Toshki Patron and Polish Patron, against which all other literatures are compared and assigned the status of literature. In response, the world has witnessed operations of deorientalization, decolonization, what Professor Ashcroft dubbed postcolonial transformation, and delinking, the last gaining greater currency in the recent years. Delinking is conceptualized and promoted by the proponents of decoloniality. Decoloniality is critical political activism that conceives of coloniality as something bigger than the historical projects of imperialism and colonialism. It is an epochal condition and an epistemological frame that love binds these historical projects to modernity in an inseparable manner. Thus, modernity establishes its totality by positing an outside of global north. This outside of global north, which we now call global south, is excluded from modernity through a discourse of racism. Decoloniality is about subverting epistemological and ecological coloniality. Now, premised upon Peruvian sociologist Aníbal Viana's contention that coloniality has survived cartographic colonization, delinking is disconnection. Acknowledging the connection with colonial power, but severing the necessity of ties with colonial powers and establishing new geopolitical miasma. Delinking is deemed a set of decolonizing and deindustrializing strategies that may help Global South regain and retain economic, political, and epistemological dignity vis-a-vis Global South. In Walter Pinero's words, delinking is a means of breaking off, quote, breaking off from the coloniality of knowledge controlled and managed by the theo-ego and organological principles of knowledge and its consequences. Delinking contains on the control of our subjectivity and our imaginary, our discrimination over here. In a recent writing, Miglono further clarified the proposition. Delinking involves, quote, building the knowledge we need for our own liberation rather than contributing to the knowledge they need for our subjective enslavement. This definition conception has three aspects and that my paper is resourced from. One of the first three aspects is from Egyptian French scholar Samir Amin's proposal for political and economical delinking, which he calls actual and active delinking. Actual and active delinking or disconnection is not adjusting the periphery to the demands of capitalism. Rather, comparing capitalism or comparing center to be customized to meet the internal requirements. The second connotation comes from Piano's epistemic delinking, that is, delinking from the rhetoric of modernity and the logic of coloniality. The third from Dijakovic's conception of decentration. It involves self-intervention, that is, decentering of subjective and decentering of narcissism. It involves simultaneous study of both the observed object and the observing subject. Ecological dealing enables an individual to transcend its polarity and learn from diversity. Here lies the advantage of dealing. Now, taking cues from all these concepts and strategies, I conceptualize dealing as a perennial affective strategy that aggressively comes to terms with the economical, epistemological, and ideological domination and arrogance of global norm. Aggression is a phenomenon that informs the third phase of dealing that I propose that we are in. Gone are the phases of damage control and self-representation, of strategic marketing and price bidding, of being celebrated but ultimately ghettoed in ethnic or exotic pigeonholes of literature. Now is the committed projection of aggressive penetration of world marketing and ideas and aggressive critical affective intervention in the global north imaginary that my paper touches upon. So, referencing Brexit, I offer a kind of insight. To summarize, the act of delinking the study of English literatures in Bangladesh involves three delinking strategies. First, the epistemic dislinking, the delinking, which involves, among others, taking into account the conflicting histories of England, Ireland, Scotland, and Wales. For example, the introductory courses on European history or English history must include England's internal colonialism that explains why English language became the dominant one in the archipelago. Second, the ecological relinking, which involves, among others, exploring Ireland, Scotland, and Wales, ambivalent relations with England, with each other, and with the world outside. Yet, double consciousness that papers I talked about is an issue here. Third is the political economic delinking, which involves, among others, generating more funds and scholarships for advanced studies in, say, Welsh poetry and Scottish theatre. The attitude must be critical effective, involving criticality and passion, anger and ethics, a combo that affirms yet transcends insularity and narcissism in its need to express of which the others, the internal other and the external other. Now, basing on the emancipatory potential of delinking, I propose that the general term English literature be rephrased as the Anglophone literatures of the British and Irish arts in Bangladesh. Well, if it sounds too exotic or giving, but if we still insist on keeping Joyce and Thomas in a degraded English literature, let's really meet Anglophone Irish literature. And it's guess. What's guess? A couple of weeks back, when the European Commission announced that its working language will no more be British English, rather Irish English, a Commission interpreter explained, that's going to be guess. Guess is an Irish word for amusing. Brexit may be a guess. Engexit is guess. The second section is titled Critical Archaeologic Approach, and to which these letters first clarify what we mean by the British and the Irish Isles. In 1993, Susan Bassnett proposed the term British Isles to overcome the terminological problems that England and its archipelagic neighbors involved. However, inclusion of the Republic of Ireland in a term that is British remained contentious. Therefore, many scholars tended to offer an Atlantic archipelago, even East Atlantic archipelago, but not neither worked. In 2015, John Brannigan used the phrase Irish and British Isles. I opted for the term British and Irish Isles because of its non-metropolitan thrust and also its iconic nature. It exposes and corrects the ideology underpinning more established and non-metropolitan we are familiar with. The phrase Anglophone literatures of the British and Irish Isles designates literatures composed in English in the British Isles. The term invokes a network that invokes a postcolonial non-metropolitan perspective to study and teach literatures in English of the British and Irish archipelago. Now comes the question of archipelago. We know that archipelago is an extensive group of islands. So consequently, the term archipelagic designates the geographical nature of an archipelago or epistemological status of an archipelago, or aesthetic production of an archipelago. Consequently, archipelagic studies broaches the political, spatial, and cultural issues pertaining to the archipelagos of the world, for example, the Malay archipelago and the Caribbean Sea, including the British and Irish archipelago. Archipelagic studies is different from isology or island studies. Island studies have its focus on the island characteristics, for example, the nature of water, standard condition, etc. Archipelagic studies is interested in the dialogy or diatopical interaction between the constituents of the archipelagic zone. For a further study, we may also take up archipelagic thinking, that is, whether and how the constituents of an archipelago form a particular way of thinking, a particular way of epistemology that may help our understanding of British Irish lives. So, critical archipelagic approach has three features. First, it is metacognitive. But before that, let us talk about the place-centric positioning of this critical archipelagic approach. We are well aware that place is an important element in identity formation. In his special essay on the rhetoric, poetics, and politics of place, Noah Page demonstrates how place is materially and cognitively hierarchical. That is how the construction of a place as the center reduces the neighboring places, or automatically reducing the neighboring places as superiority. The construction of an Anglo-American center in the British Isles was premised upon political rhetoric of national unity and cultural uniformity, thus homogenizing the differences. In order to generate a non-metropolitan perspective, Beats therefore envisions a new aesthetics of place that defamiliarizes the automatized and habituated perceptions and experience of place, that destabilizes centrism and regionality, and that initiates decentralization and pluralistic territory. Addressing the epistemological and geopolitical dimension of the British and Irish Islands, I conceptualize the archipelagic as a diatopical site of struggle for meaning, not between the center and periphery, rather between the entities that are antagonistic yet inter-animating relation with each other. Taking cue from this critical archipelagic approach involves mobilizing diatopical means of exploring the relations between the constituents of an archipelago. If some of you are not familiar with the word diatopical, diatopical is about two discourses or entities which come from or name from different places. So this is a bigger, a broader term than dialogical. So when we are talking of diatopical, we are foreground the place and also the dialogical interaction between them. This takes me to the third part of my presentation, that is critical archaeologic mode of teaching literatures of the British and Irish Isles. So the first is the critical archaeologic mode that I offer. Now it has three major features. First, that as a pedagogic means, it is metacognitive. Second, it is critical effective, that it offers an in-front combination of criticality and affect. By criticality, I mean the cerebral, the political, inclusiveness, instrumentality, ethics. And by affect, I mean the visceral, the senses, sensations, and sensibilities, emotions, feelings, and individuality. And third, this archaeologic approach involves comparative methodology. For example, addressing the hegemony of English language and addressing the center-periphery paradigm. Critical archaeologic mode as a pedagogic means has five consummated constituents. First is the syllabus that I'm not focusing on. What it means is that having a representative sampling of Irish, Scottish and Welsh literatures.
by Englishness.
Second is genres. That is sampling the visual genres, including graphic novels and horror novels. Third is the Englishness. So when we think of Anglophone literatures of the British arts, we must not think of some standard English only. It involves a bigger area, including Irish, Scottish, Welsh variants of English. Then there are dialects, synthetic Englishes, let alone contemporary pop influencing. Then the syllabus must include all these variations. Fourth is creative expressive method, that the mode of teaching involves creativity and expressivity. I would like to concentrate on the final point, that is critical archaeopedagogic interaction. This is in brief the pedagogic needs, that is the skills, senses and sensibilities that this pedagogic mode mobilizes. I will focus on some of it by developing reciprocity and cooperation, enhancing association and recollection, making things relevant. This is what teachers should do or may do while dealing with literatures, here particularly handled literatures of the British and Irish arts. The second aspect of critical archaeological interaction is context. So there are two things that it involves. One is redoing our existing approaches of teaching literatures, English literatures. For example, when we approach the dream of the root, we should relate to its Scottish background. When we are approaching George Herbert, when we are approaching William Shakespeare's Macbeth, when we are approaching the Bluebeards by Jashim, we need to address the archaeological relations these texts have that we often forget, apart from our sometimes focus on Scotland or England or England, Ireland, political conflicts, but there something more is involved. Second is introducing new entries, for example, introducing the people of Europe if we want to include Kim, Welsh and Irish writers in place, and introducing Carol and Duffy, Scottish writer, also known the poet laureate. Introducing them might be an important point. The last point is that big text, that is, how do we approach a particular text? I'm just offering a list of it. For example, a critical archaeological approach to Shema's Yiddish is anaphorous, may involve this text. For example, listening to the sounds. It is a kind of common thing. I mean, when we teach a poem, much of the charm of a poem relies on the sound. That is fine. But when we are dealing with anaphorous, we should understand our scope. The sound is here also a political means, a kind of assertion. First is that anaphorous, the very stress on ha, is kind of un-English, and this is something very Irish that meaning focuses on. The second is the name itself possesses. Simply, Burris argues that the name itself possesses inevitable powers of cultural sovereignty. The poem dexterously appropriates a landscape which is politically British in its legal demarcation, but with its linguistically Irish in its nomenclature, because Anna British is an Irish name. The third point would be that what does Anna British Irish mean? I'm interested in the etymology of Anna British. The meaning is actually given the very first line of the poem. The question is, if we move to the next point, look at the Anaphorish on the map. And if we organize students to search for it or give them some newspaper reports, then we find that Anaphorish does not exist on the map. In fact, any townland that was born in does not exist in reality. The reports tell us that the official name of the place is Quick. No place named Anaphorish exists. After learners finish reading the report, they will understand the politics of place and placement. Did Edie create a place or did Edie invent a place? And the question is why? This is an important point that somehow foregrounds the promise of potential sound. The very pronunciation of Anaphorish that compromises with English pronunciation is a kind of linguistic subversion of the dominance of English. And at the same time, it is a resistance against the political language, and it subverts it and renames it by an Irish name. therefore the very song is post-colonial and resisting this nature. So this takes me to the end of the conclusion that people are afraid of the global south. We understand that people are afraid of global south. Even when we are afraid of coronavirus, Professor Ashcroft came here, but I did not go to Kerala today. One of the reasons is this coronavirus. Yes, it's a fact, but at the same time, we understand that how much racism is involved in it. And maybe all this has something to do with what Peter Franklin has said, that you still brought, or the Shushin have said, that you brought disorder, and some people, the global north might be afraid of global south. So if it's a type of transcolonialism, of decoloniality, decolonization, de-linking, we need to rethink of the transformative power of anger. So this takes me to the beginning or the end of the aggressive sarcasm in which we will start. So in this phase of re-emergence, anger is a valid piece as long as it is non-narcissistic. To conclude, critical archaeologic de-linking as a pedagogic piece may appear angry. And it is so. I contend that formulating and practicing critical archaeologic teaching English language in Bangladesh has every potential to counter cognitive colonization and activate a nuanced yet emotive and politically aware approach to the social, historical, cultural, and political factors that intervene in the production, distribution, and consumption of the literatures of the British and Irish colonies. On its sound, that is fine. But when we are dealing with Anahuris, we should understand and underscore that sound is here also a political means and kind of assertion. First is that Anahuris, the very stress on A, is kind of Anahuris, and this is something very Irish that PD focuses on. The second is the name itself possesses. Simply, Burris argues that the name itself possesses ineffable powers of cultural sovereignty. The poem dexterously appropriates a landscape which is politically British in its legal demarcation, but which is linguistically Irish in its nomenclature, because Anahuris is an Irish name. The second, the third point would be that what does Anahuris in Irish mean? I mean, tracing the etymology of Anahuris. The meaning is actually given the very first line of the poem. The question is, if we move to the next point, locating Anahuris on the map, and if we mobilize students to search for it or give them some newspaper reports, then we will find that Anahuris does not exist on the map. In fact, any townland that he was born in does not exist in reality. The reports tell us that the official name of the place is Crib. No place named Anahuris exists. After learners finished reading the report, they will understand the politics of place and place name. Did we need fake a place or did we need invent a place? And the question is why? This is an important point that somehow foregrounds the promise or potentiality of sound. The very pronunciation of Anahuris that compromises with English pronunciation is a kind of linguistic subversion of the dominance of English, and at the same time, it is a resistance against the political name Creek, and it subverts it and renames it by an Irish name. Therefore, the very sound is post-colonial and resistive in its nature. I will take 1 minute. So this takes me to the end of the conclusion that Indians are afraid of the global sound. We understand that people are afraid of global south. Even when we are afraid of coronavirus, Professor Ashcroft came here, but I did not go to Kerala today. One of the reasons is this coronavirus. Yes, it's a fact, but at the same time, we understand that how much racism is involved in it. And maybe all this has something to do with what Peter Frankopan said, that you still throws, what the Shushitram said, that you brought disorder, and some people, that this global north might be afraid of Global South. So in this age of transcolonialism, of decoloniality, decolonization, de-linking, we need to rethink of the transformative power of anger. So this takes me to the beginning or the end of the aggressive circus of which maybe starts. So in this phase of re-emergence, anger is a valid piece as long as it is non-narcissistic. To conclude, critical archipelagic delinking as a pedagogic piece may appear angry, and it is so. I contend that formulating and practicing critical archipelagic mode in teaching English literature in Bangladesh has every potential to counter cognitive colonization and activate a nuanced yet emotive and politically aware approach to the social, historical, cultural, and political factors that intervene in the production, distribution, and consumption of the literatures of the British and Irish artists. Thank you. Relating differences, we need to identify the differences. But what happens when we somehow try to ignore differences and homogenize? This is the focus of my paper. So the title is Delinking English Literature Pedagogy Bangladesh Towards a Critical Pedagogical Approach. Now, let me start with a common yet complicated question. If the UK competes as Team GB in the Olympic, why does it play football as individual countries, say England and Scotland? A more confusing question is, do you cover England in the English football team and England in the England cricket team mean the same? The answer is no. The England cricket team comprises England and Wales. This terminological problem becomes more disorienting when someone attempts to differentiate between Britain, United Kingdom, and the British Isles. To be precise, acknowledging debates, we may say that Great Britain refers to a political island nation, United Kingdom a geopolitical entity, and British Isles a geographical or archipelagic entity. Now, finding one's way through these complexities is not only complex, but in many cases it can become offensive if it puts your identity at stake. When Shivasini was included in the 1982 Penguin Book of Contemporary British Poetry, he responded in a sarcastic poem and wrote a letter. This is the British arts. So Shivasini responded in a sarcastic one and open letter. I hate to write, hence that led me to the limelight. In the Penguin Book, I regret your preface. British, no, the name's not right. It is therefore unfortunate that similar kind of uncritical, hence allegedly politically offensive activities are evident in the departments of English in the world. In Bangladesh, to focus the English language or Anglophone literatures of Ireland, Scotland, and Wales have been uncritically crammed under the umbrella term English literature. Thus, English literature syllabuses feature Anglophone Irish James Joyce, Anglophone Welsh Dylan Thomas as English writers. However, Anglophone Nigerian Chinua Achebe and Anglophone Canadian Margaret Atwood are not the English proper. And often is British deemed synonymous with English. Such British-large interest in homogenization has led to two hegemonic pedagogic process. First, naturalization of the ambiguity and superiority that literature produced in England, and second, invisibilization of the different, often oppositional, histories and trajectories of the Anglophone and non-Anglophone literatures of Ireland, Scotland, and Wales. In response, my paper samples a strategy of delineating the English literature pedagogy in Bangladesh. The question that spurred my paper is, should the Joyce and Thomas be put in a differently titled courses, say, Anglophone, Welsh, and Irish literatures? Addressing these paradoxes and perplexities, John Brannigan, who wrote a useful book, Archipelagic Modernism, he located two modes that dominate the study of literature of the British Isles. The first is the Anglo-centric mode that views Joyce and Yeats as exemplary of metropolitan modernism. The other is national narrative mode that views Joyce and Yeats as predominantly in relation to their Irish national traditions. What may strike a productive synergy is a critical affective mode that I would like to call critical archipelagic mode. For Brannigan, the archipelagic accommodates the post-evolutionary or post-decentralization cultural context of the study of literatures of the British Isles. If Brexit is Britain's exit from European Union, post-evolution is exit from the political and cultural domination of England in the British archipelago. Archipelagic approach endorses decentration, but I would like to call
it.
Thus, it remains sensitive to what is distinctive about the linguistic, cultural, and political histories of literature in each of the constituent parts of the archipelago. My today's talk proposes a critical archipelagic mode as a pedagogic mechanism at the universities in Bangladesh to link the study of literatures of England from the study of Anglophone literatures of Ireland, Scotland, and Wales. And here goes the three sections through which my argument will unfold. The first section tells the emancipatory potential of delinking the study of the literatures of the British and Irish Isles in Bangladesh. The second section enumerates what I mean by critical pedagogical approach, critical archipelagic approach, and the third section outlines a critical archipelagic mode of teaching literatures of the British and Irish Isles in Bangladesh. So the first section, I need to, before I start it, need to shed back some light on delinking. We in Global South reached the conviction that Global South poetics and literatures provide literary, theoretical, and critical touchstones and philosopher stones, a kind of push department and porch button, against which all other literatures are compared and assigned the status of literature. In response, the world has witnessed operations of deorientalization, decolonization, what Professor Ashcroft dubbed postcolonial transformation, and delinking, the last gaining greater currency in the recent years. Delinking is conceptualized and promoted by the proponents of decoloniality. Decoloniality is critical political activism that conceives of coloniality as something bigger than the historical projects of imperialism and colonialism. It is an epochal condition and an epistemological frame that love binds these historical projects to modernity in an inseparable manner. Thus, modernity establishes its totality by positing an outside of global thought. This outside of global thought, which may now call Global South, is excluded from modernity through a discourse of racism. Decoloniality is about subverting epistemological and ecological coloniality. Now, premised upon Peruvian sociologist Anton Dumiano's contention that coloniality has survived cartographic colonization, delinking is disconnection. Acknowledging the connection with colonial power, but severing the necessity of ties with colonial powers and establishing new geopolitical nuances. Delinking is deemed a set of decolonizing and de-westernizing strategies. that may help Global South regain and retain economic, political, and epistemological dignity vis-a-vis Global South. In Walter Pinomo's words, delinking is a means of breaking off, quote, breaking off from the coloniality of knowledge controlled and managed by the theo, ego, and organological principles of knowledge and its consequences. Delinking then aims for the control of our subjectivity and our imaginary, our distribution of here. In a recent writing, McLuhan further clarified the proposition. Delinking involves, quote, building the knowledge we need for our own liberation rather than contributing to the knowledge they need for our subjective enslavement. This definition or conception has three aspects and that my paper is resourced from. One of the first three aspects is from Egyptian French scholar Samir Hamid's proposal for political and economical delinking, which he calls actual and active delinking. Actual and active delinking of this connection is not adjusting the periphery to the demands of capitalism, rather comparing capitalism or comparing center to be customized to meet the internal requirements. The second connotation comes from Guiano's epistemic delinking, that is, delinking from the rhetoric of modernity and the logic of coloniality. The third from Guy Jukoy's conception of decentration. It involves self-intervention, that is, decentering of subjective and decentering of narcissism. It involves simultaneous study of both the observed object and the observing subject. Ecological delinking enables an individual to transcend its polarity and learn from diversity. Here lies the patterns of delinking. Now, taking cues from all these concepts and strategies, I conceptualize delinking as a critical affective strategy that aggressively comes to terms with the economical, epistemological, and ideological domination and arrogance of global knowledge. Aggression is a phenomenon that informs the third phrase of delinking that I propose that we are in. Gone are the phases of damage control and self-representation, of strategic marketing and price bidding, of being celebrated but ultimately ghettoed in ethnic or exotic pigeonholes of literature. Now is the committed projection of aggressive penetration of world marketing area and aggressive political affective introduction to the global market agenda. So, referencing Brexit, I offer a kind of insight. To summarize, the act of delinking, the study of English literatures in Bangladesh involves three delinking strategies. First, the epistemic enslavement, the delinking, which involves, among others, taking into account a conflicting history of England, Ireland, Scotland, and Wales. For example, the introductory courses on European history or English history must accommodate England's internal colonialism that explains why English language became the dominant one in the archipelago. Second, the ecological delinking, which involves, among others, exploring Ireland, Scotland, and Wales, ambivalent relation with England, with each other, and with the world outside. Yes, doubt consciousness that papers I talked about is an issue here. Third is the political economic delinking, which involves another generating more funds and scholarships for advanced studies in, say, Welsh poetry and Scottish theatre. The attitude must be critical, effective, involving criticality and passion, anger and ethics, a combo that performs yet transcends insularity and narcissism. Is free to express and reach the others, the internal other and the external other. Now, basing on the emancipatory potential of delinking, I propose that the general term English literature be rephrased as Anglophone literatures of the British and Irish arts in Bangladesh. Well, if it sounds exotic or gimmick, but if we still insist on keeping Joyce and Thomas in a divinate English literature, let's really meet Anglophone Irish literature and its guess. What's guess? A couple of weeks back, the European Commission announced that its working language will no more be British English, rather Irish English. A Parisian interpreter explained, "That's going to be guess." Guess is an Irish word for amusing. Brexit may be a guess. Engexit is guess. The second section is titled Critical Archaeological Approach, and which the suggesters clarify what we mean by the British and the Irish Isles. In 1993, Susan Besant proposed the term British Isles to overcome the terminological problems that England and its archipelagic neighbors evoked. However, inclusion of the Republic of Ireland in a term that is British remained contentious. Therefore, many scholars tended to opt for an Atlantic archipelago, even East Atlantic archipelago, but not either worked. In 2015, John Brannigan used the phrase Irish and British Isles. I opted for the term British and Irish Isles because of its non-metropolitan thrust and also its academic nature. It exposes and corrects the ideology underpinning more established and more nomenclature we are familiar with. The phrase Anglophone literatures of the British and Irish Isles designates literatures composed in English in the British Isles. The term invokes a network that invokes a post-colonial non-metropolitan perspective to study and teach literatures in English of the British, Irish, Arabic, and Latin. Now, comes the question of archipelago. We know that archipelago is an extensive group of islands. So, consequently, the term archipelago designates the geographical nature of an archipelago, or the epistemological status of an archipelago, or aesthetic production of an archipelago. Consequently, archipelagic studies broaches the political, spatial, and cultural issues pertaining to the archipelago. Those of the world, for example, the Malay archipelago, the Caribbean Sea, including the British and Irish archipelago. Archipelagic studies is different from isology or island studies. Island studies have its focus on the island characteristics, for example, the nature of water, standard condition, etc. Archipelagic studies is interested in the dialogic or diatopical interaction between the constituents of the archipelago concerned. For a further study, we may also think of archipelagic thinking, that is, whether and how the constituents of an archipelago form a particular way of thinking, a particular way of epistemology that may help our understanding of British and Irish Isles. So, critical archipelagic approach has three features. First, it is metacognitive, but before that, let us talk about the place and prepositioning of this critical archaeological approach. We are well aware that place is an important element in identity formation. In his special essay on the rhetoric, poetics, and politics of place, Noah Bates demonstrates how place is materially and cognitively hierarchical. That is how the construction of a place as the center reduces the neighboring places or automatically reducing the neighboring places as periphery. The construction of an Anglo-American center in the British Isles was premised upon political rhetoric of national unity and cultural uniformity, thus homogenizing the differences. In order to generate a non-metropolitan perspective, Beats therefore envisions a new aesthetics of place that defamiliarizes the automatized and habituated perceptions and experience of place, that destabilizes centrism and regionalism, and that initiates decentralization and pluralistic territorialism. Addressing the epistemological and geopolitical dimension of the British and Irish Islands, I conceptualize the archipelagic as a diatopical site of struggle for meaning, not between the center and periphery, rather between the entities that have antagonistic yet inter-animating relation with each other. Taking cue from this, critical archaeologic approach involves mobilizing diatopical means of exploring the relations between the constituents of an archipelago. if some of you are not familiar with the word diatomical is about two discourses or entities which come from or came from different places. So this is a bigger or broader term than dialogical. So when we are talking of diatopical, we are foreground the place and also the dialogical interaction between them. This takes me to the third part of my presentation, that is critical archaeologic mode of teaching literatures of the British and Irish Isles. So the first is the critical archaeologic mode that I offer. Now it has three major features. First, that as a pedagogic means, it is metacognitive. Second, it is critical effective, that it offers an informed combination of criticality and affect. By criticality, I mean the cerebral, the political, inclusiveness, instrumentality, ethics. And by affect, I mean the visceral, the senses, sensations, and sensibilities, emotions, feelings, and individuality. And third, this archaeologic approach involves strong narrative methodology. For example, addressing the hegemony of the English language and addressing the center-periphery paradigm. Critical archaeologic mode as a pedagogic means has five major constituents. First is the syllabus that I'm not focusing on. What it means is that having a representative sampling of Irish, Scottish, and Welsh literatures. Second is genres, that is sampling the major genres including graphic novels and horror novels. Third is the Englishes. So when we think of Anglophone literatures of the British Isles, we must not think of some standard English only. It involves a bigger area, including Irish, Scottish, Welsh variants of English. Then there are dialect, synthetic Englishes, let alone contemporary pop influenced English. Then the syllabus must include all these variations. Both these creative expressive methods that are mode of teaching involves creativity and expressivity. I would like to concentrate on the final point, that is critical archaeologic interaction. This is in brief the pedagogic means, that is the skills, senses, and sensibilities that this pedagogic mode mobilizes. I will focus on some of it by developing reciprocity and cooperation, enhancing association and recollection, making things better. This is what teachers should do or may do while dealing with literatures, here particularly Anglophone literatures of the British and Irish Isles. The second aspect of critical archaeological interaction is context. So there are two things that it involves. One is redoing our existing approaches of teaching literatures, English literatures. For example, when we approach the dream of the root, we should relate to its Scottish background. When we are approaching George Herbert, when we are approaching William Shakespeare's Macbeth, when we are approaching the Tribute by Jashim, we need to address the archaeological relations these texts have that we often forget, apart from our sometimes focus on Scotland or England or England-Ireland political conflicts, but there something more is involved. Second is introducing new entries, for example, introducing the figure group if we want to include keep Welsh and Irish writers in place, and introducing Carol and Duffy, a Scottish writer, but also a poet laureate, introducing their mind in one point. The last point is the big text, that is, how do we approach a particular text? I'm just offering a list of it. For example, a critical archaeological approach to Shema's Finnish is Anna Boris may involve these things. For example, listening to the sounds. It is a kind of common thing. I mean, when we teach a poem, much of the charm of a poem relies on its sound. That is fine. But when we are dealing with Anna Boris, we should understand or underscore that sound is here also a political means, a kind of assertion. First is that anaphoris, the very stress on ha, is kind of un-English, and this is something very Irish that Amy focuses on. The second is the name itself possesses, simply Mary's argues that the name itself possesses ineffable powers of cultural sovereignty. The poem dexterously appropriates a landscape which is politically British in its legal demarcation, but which is linguistically Irish in its common expression, because Anna Horish is an Irish name. The third point would be that what does Anna Horish in Irish mean? I'm interested in the etymology of Anna Horish. The meaning is actually given, the very first line of the poem. The question is, if you go to the next point, look at Anna Horish on the map, and if the alternate students to search for it, or give them some newspaper reports, that we find that Anna Horish does not exist on the map. In fact, any combat that was known does not exist in reality. The reports tell us that the official name of the place is fake. No place named Anna Horish exists. After learners finish reading the report, they will understand the politics of place and place naming. Did he fake a place or did he invent a place? And the question is, why? This is the important point that somehow foregrounds the promise of potentiality of sound. The very pronunciation of Anna Horish that compromises with English pronunciation is a kind of linguistic subversion of the dominance of English, and at the same time, it is a resistance against the political name, and it subverts it and renames it by an Irish name. Therefore, the very sound is postcolonial and resistant to English. The end of the conclusion that people have agreed on the global south. We understand that people are agreed on global south. Even when we are agreed on coronavirus, Professor Ashok came here, but I did not look here today. One of the reasons is this coronavirus. Yes, it's a fact, but at the same time, we understand how much racism is involved in it. And maybe politics have something to do with it. But Peter Franco can say that the Eastern Brooks, or should you come say that the world is on Earth, and some people that is global power might be afraid of global south. So it is a good transcolonialism of decolonization, dealing with. We need to rethink of the transformative power of anger. So these texts are the beginning of the end of the aggressive circus between stars. So in this phase of re-emergence, anger is a valid thing as long as it is non-persistent. To conclude, critical archaeologic delicting as a pedagogic means may appear angry, and it is so. I contend that formulating and practicing critical archaeologic teaching English languages in Bangladesh has every potential to counter cognitive colonization and activate a nuanced yet emotive and politically aware approach to the social, historical, cultural, and political factors that intervene in the production, distribution, and consumption of the literatures of the British and Irish arts. On its sum, that is mine. But when we are dealing with Anna Horish, we should understand and underscore that South is here also a political means and a kind of assertion. First is that Anna Horish, the very stress on A, is kind of un-English, and this is something very Irish that Kini focuses on. The second is the name itself possesses. Simply, Burris argues that the name itself possesses ineffable powers of cultural sovereignty. The poem dexterously appropriates a landscape which is politically British in its legal demarcation, but which is linguistically Irish in its common expression, because Anna Horish is an Irish name. The third point would be that what does Anna Horish in Irish mean? I'm interested in the etymology of Anna Horish. The meaning is actually given, the very first line of the poem. The question is, if you move to the next point, locating Anna Horish on the map, and if we mobilize students to search for it or give them some newspaper reports, then we will find that Anna Horish does not exist on the map. In fact, any townland that it was born in does not exist in reality. The reports tell us that the official name of the place is Uddin. No place named Anakurish exists. After learners finish reading the report, they will understand the politics of place and place name. Did he need to fake a place or did he need to invent a place? And the question is why? This is an important point that somehow foregrounds the promise or potentiality of sound. The very pronunciation of Anakurish that compromises with English pronunciation is a kind of linguistic subversion of the dominance of English, and at the same time, it is a resistance against the political name of it, and it subverts it and renames it by an Irish name. Therefore, the very sound is post-colonial and resisting against nature. So this takes me to the end of the conclusion that people are afraid of the global sound. We understand that people are afraid of global sound. Even when we are afraid of coronavirus, Professor Ashok came here, but I didn't go here today. One of the reasons is this coronavirus. Yes, it's a fact, but at the same time, we understand that how much racism is involved in it. And maybe all this has something to do with it. But Peter Frankenman said that you still broke, but the Shunikar said that you were dishonored, and some people that this global problem might be afraid of global south. So in this age of transcolonialism, of decoloniality, decolonization, de-linking, we need to rethink of the transformative power of anger. So this takes me to the beginning or the end of the aggressive sarcasm with which my paper starts. So in this phase of re-emergence, anger is a valid means as long as it is non-narcissistic. To conclude, critical archipelagic de-linking as a pedagogic means may appear angry, and it is so. I contend that formulating and practicing critical archipelagic mode in teaching English literature in Bangladesh has every potential to counter cognitive colonization, activate a nuanced yet emotive and politically aware approach to the social, historical, cultural, and political factors that intervene in the production, distribution, and consumption of the literatures of the British and Irish lands.